Please give it up for Matt Heller.
How about we give it up one more time for LaTanya and friends? And welcome, everybody, to our special live recording of Feeney Talks with Friends, episode number 100. My name is Matt Heller. I'm on the board of director of Friends of Feeney. And before we get started tonight, I'm going to give a little background about why we're here tonight and thank everybody who made this event special. So for those of you who don't know, Friends of Feeney is a nonprofit organization based right here in West Hartford. It was started about 10 years ago by our founder and president, Eric Feeney. He is a third grade teacher in West Hartford, and over... About a decade ago, Eric witnessed over the course of a year two of his students lose their fathers, one to an unexpected medical illness and one to gun violence. Eric knew that he needed to do something special and something more substantial than just raising money through a GoFundMe. So out of that, Friends of Feeney was built as a community-based organization. In 2019, we became an official 501c3 nonprofit, and since then, we've raised over $150,000 for 35-plus families. Now, to give a little bit of a backstory on the Feeney Talks with Friends podcast, a couple years ago, Eric was a guest on Behind the Brand, which is a podcast hosted by Dave Shimaluski of Direct Line Media. Eric talked about Friends of Feeney on his episode, but by the end, he wanted to be the one in front of the camera asking questions to local community members. Shocking, right? Shocking, if you know Eric. So out of that, Feeney Talks with Friends was born, and here we are 100 episodes later. We've talked with educators, teachers, business leaders, athletes, you name it. Everybody doing amazing work in the community. So now I'd like to thank some of our sponsors. First of all, our producer, Direct Line Media. We're a 100% based, volunteer-based organization, and this simply wouldn't be possible without a professional production crew. So Direct Line Media does just that. Thank you to Dave, the owner, our producer, Stefania, and the rest of the crew here tonight. Give it up for Direct Line. We've also got a wonderful set of podcast sponsors who provide us with monetary support. They give us a location to shoot. Some of them even do both. So those sponsors are Luna Pizza, Donut Crazy, Keating Agency Insurance, Parkville Management, West Hartford Lock, Luna Pizza, and...
There's one more.
Golf Law Group. So please give it up for all our wonderful sponsors. And we have a very special presenting sponsor tonight, French Cleaners on Farmington Ave here in West Hartford. So a little bit of a backstory there. Episode 91 of Feeney Talks with Friends was a very special episode. We had a fundraiser for the Real Men Wear Pink initiative of the American Cancer Society. We had Avi Smith-Rappaport of We Care Computers and Jorge Castro of Discover Me Web. I know you're both in the crowd tonight, so shout out to you both. But anyways, during that episode, we were eating hot wings, and you know, knowing Feeney, he drops one all over his brand new button-up shirt. It was one wing, but he managed to cover half of that with wing sauce. So anyways, he brings that over to French Cleaners, and by the next episode, it was good as new. So it's only fitting that French Cleaners is our presenting sponsor tonight, and we have a feeling this won't be the last time that they get business out of one of our productions. So give it up for French Cleaners. All right, next up, we have to thank our vendors tonight, Dora Restaurant Group for the food, Weehaw Brewing and Roasting and Maximum Beverage for the drinks. This isn't the first time, and this isn't the last time that they're going to be supporting us. Dora has been amazing. They cater to many of our events, including our annual golf tournament, Weehaw Brewing and Roasting Co. We host numerous events over there, including many of our podcasts, and we're honored to be the charity beneficiary of Maximum Beverage's Weehaw Whiskey Festival and their Champagne Spectacular. So give it up for our wonderful vendors tonight. Yeah. And how about Latanya and friends? Aren't they amazing? Latanya is the singing principal and guest number 99 on the Feeney Talks with Friend podcast, so please check that one out. And the band graciously came here tonight to sing for us, so we're so happy to have them here. One more time, give it up for Latanya and friends. And finally, our venue tonight, Playhouse on Park. What an awesome space this is for the community. We had episode 50 here, and the way that we're going, we have so many people left to talk in the community who are doing great things, so we expect to be back here for episode 150 and 200 quite soon. Thank you to Tracey and the whole crew for all the support and the resources they've given us. Give it up for Playhouse on Park. All right, that is enough of me. So what do we think? Should we get this show started?
All right.
It is my honor to welcome our first guest tonight. So please help me welcome alongside our president and founder, Eric Feeney. He is a singer, songwriter, and winner of season one of The Voice, Javier Colon.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood.
A beautiful
day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? Sing it, Eric, sing it.
It's a beautiful day on Park Road. A beautiful day on Park Road. Could you be mine? Would you be mine? I've always wanted to have a friend just like
I always wanted to have a friend just like
you.
Well, I always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you, so let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Everybody sing it. Won't you be my neighbor?
My good friend.
My good friend.
My good friend.
Good friends. Well done.
Let's go.
Well done. Let's go.
Won't you be my good friend?
Good friend.
Mr. Rogers is my idol. You know, I'm just trying to be like Mr. Rogers. Raised me.
That was a good start. If you're trying to be like him, that's good. Hi, everybody. So good to be here. This is awesome. Thank you for having me. Harry, I'm honored.
Just got to learn how to clap on beat, have rhythm, sing. But I'm there. I'm getting there.
Baby steps. Baby steps.
Huge steps. Thank you to Matt. Thank you. Give it up
to Matt.
He said everything I didn't have. So thank you. And thank you for the rest of our board. They're here. Why don't you come on out quickly? Rob, Marty, Jen, and Matt.
Yeah.
Our board of directors. This board of directors had completely changed the direction of Friends of Feeney. I couldn't do it without them. Jen, Matt, Rob, Marty. Nancy couldn't be here. Nancy's our secretary. So it truly means a lot. Matt took the day off today. It means so much. Marty's a retired teacher. He can go to those meetings that I can't get to. Occupational therapist, teacher, grief counselor, just an amazing team. And just thank you so much. Another round of applause. Thank you so much. Then I see some West Hartford dignitaries in the house.
Maybe.
Yes. Now, she said she's going to do a cartwheel. Cartwheel? Mayor Shari Cantor.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Here, let us thank
you. Oh, it's awesome.
Yeah. Oh, that wasn't it. I don't know. You could have some mic time too, Shari. But go back and check out Shari, wonderful podcast guest, completely supportive, just like the entire West Harvard community, a wonderful place. I live and work here. I taught at the same school that my girls went to. It was a dream come true.
Awesome.
I can't thank the West Harvard community enough. It's definitely a great place to be. They have great teachers. All right.
It's awesome.
So we're here with Javi. We're going to get into it. Again, my name is Eric Feeney, founder and president of Friends of Feeney. Our mission is to help children and families that need assistance after heartbreak or tragedy. And I use this podcast and I talk to wonderful people that are doing great things. And Javi, you do great things.
I mean, you do great things. And I'm just here to support. I'm so honored to get to be here, get to see all these lovely faces and help you do what you do for our community. So thank you for doing what you do.
You've been doing it for quite some time. Can you talk about your longevity? How do you, because one video, crazy, you're on a payphone with a box TV. On your next TV, Gravity, you're doing text messages. So
that's
you went
true,
from box TVs and payphones.
There's lots of
so
technology.
So that's a long span. Can
technology.
You talk about that?
Yeah. So you're talking about, my first single that came out back in 2003, when I was signed to Capitol Records. Gosh, that was 21 years ago now. It's insane. But that album came out in 2003. I released albums with Capitol in 03 and 06. And then I got dropped. And I was trying to find my way back in the music business. I couldn't find my way back in. Nobody wanted to give me a second chance. And I was this close to giving up. You know, things were starting to get really hard. My wife and I had my two beautiful girls at the time that were almost two and almost four. And things were just getting really tight. You know, I had ridden the wave of the Capitol Records thing as long as I could. And that's when my manager at the time sent me this email about this new show called The Voice, and that they were looking for folks to audition. And I was like, no, I'm not going to do that. That's a show. I'm not going to do a show. I don't want to do a show. I want to get a record deal the old fashioned way, like I got the first one. But it had been 5 years and I had been trying to get a record deal for 5 years, and I was still unsuccessful. So I had told some friends about it, but I had told my manager, I said, "Listen, I'm not gonna go. I don't want to do that." And he eventually, had told them he had an audition time for me, and he told them, I said, "Listen, tell them that I'm not gonna go because I don't want to be a no-show, and then they'd be mad at me, and then if I want to go second season, they're gonna be like, forget this guy, he blew us off." So I said, please tell them that I can't make it, but thank you for the opportunity. And then, a couple of weeks go by and I've been talking to people about it and everybody's saying, why? You should do it. Why aren't you doing it? So the last person I talked to 2 days before the audition was my brother. And he said, Hav, are you doing that show that you told me about? And I'm like, no, I decided I wasn't going to do it. And he was real quiet. And the next thing he said changed my mind. He said, Javier, what do you have going on in your career right now where you feel you can miss this opportunity? I thought about it, but it was a touche. I had nothing. I had nothing, and I said, you know what? You're right. What do I have to lose? I mean, I guess okay, fine. I'll do it. So I called my manager right away, and I said, hey, did you cancel that audition for me? He said, oh man, I completely forgot. And I said, you know what? Don't call them. I'm gonna go. And I went and changed my life. I'm very grateful. Sorry, that was a long answer to a question. I'm sorry.
Do you have any advice for some aspiring songwriters, singers?
Yes. My advice to aspiring songwriters and singers is to do all the things. Do all the plays, all the musicals in whether it's grade school, elementary school, high school. Do all of the things, all the town, any chance you can get to be on stage, any chance you can get to make friends in the community that this amazing community here in West Hartford that is so rich in music. We're so blessed to have to just have the teachers that we have here, to have an administration that actually cares about music in West Harvard. So we're so grateful. It's one of the reasons that I moved here, literally. But I always tell people to do everything that they can, and this is why, because when I was in sixth grade, my mom forced me to go to this like summer program that I did not want to go to. I wanted to just be out hanging with my friends, and I had to go to this 2 week thing that had it had some like science and mathy stuff, but it was fun stuff. And then it had like arts and music and drama. and they had like this, like, you know, performance that they would do at the end of it. And I met this guy there. He was the assistant to the drama director. His name was Eric Nyquist, and he was like this young 20-year-old kid, and he played guitar and he sang, and I'm like, man, this guy's cool. I was only in sixth grade. And you know, but we met, we kind of, you know, he became like somebody that I looked up to. Fast forward to when I was in high school, he reached out to me when I was a junior and he said, hey, would you be willing to come to Fairfield? I lived in Stratford, he was in Fairfield, and he wanted to know if I would do a show with the Fairfield Teen Theater for this summer program that they did. And I said, sure. So I did it. I ended up meeting a guy in the pit, the guitarist, that ended up, we became really, really good friends. We formed a band while we were in college. And then that band broke up. And then when that band broke up, the drummer was in Los Angeles working with a producer. And he said, hey, you should listen. They were working on a song with a male vocalist. And he said, hey, this guy's good, but you should listen to my friend Javier. He's in Connecticut, and we had a band, and it broke up, but you should listen to him. And he played one of our songs that we'd recorded. And that guy ended up calling me, and he's the guy who got me my deal with Capitol Records. So had I not done this stupid thing in sixth grade, I would not have had my first record deal with Capitol Records. So that's why I say you have to do everything, and you have to make all the friends that you can, and just be kind to people. You never know where your opportunity is going to come from. It could be just this random thing that you have no idea, that you think is super insignificant, and nothing is insignificant. Every relationship that you make means something. So, yeah, that's my advice.
Yeah. It goes with our motto, right? Be a good friend. I say it all the time. Pick up trash that's not yours. Yep. Hold the door. Give a compliment and be charitable.
Yes.
If you're not giving to Friends of Feeney, there's a lot of nonprofits. Find one that fits your heart. I always shout out Johnny's Jog. I know they're here. Johnny's Jog.
Yeah.
Johnny Jog is a big one. I love Johnny's Jog. Food Share. Again, find something in your heart and then donate, volunteer.
Yeah.
Yeah, 2011, The Voice, your babies. They're seniors in high school, and then they were babies in that video. That was crazy.
It's crazy. Well, she's junior. Don't fast forward too quick. She's a junior. She's a young junior. She's 16, and yeah, she'll be in college when she's 17. It's crazy to me that time has flown so quickly. And it's funny that we're talking about The Voice because we just, you know, 3 weeks or so ago, we started watching the first season of The Voice as a family. And they never saw it really because they saw it, but they were 2 and 4 and they don't remember any of it. So we've been watching it as a family and it's been super cool just to kind of, to have that experience with my kids. And they're like, Dad, that was so cool. That, oh my God. It's just fun stuff. So we've been enjoying that, but yeah, time flies. Our son wasn't even born yet at the time. So it was, it's crazy how time just kind of escapes us.
How did it feel when Blake Lively didn't turn around? Were you like, come on, buddy, turn around? Or you see it when they were like three turned around? And
I saw it and I was like, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to get him. I was like, I had that last long little riff thing at the end and he finally was like, dang it, I'll press my button. And inside I was like, yes, but I couldn't do that.
And then serious question. How much do I look like Adam Levine? I hear it all the time. Especially in like 2001, Sexiest Man Alive.
Right?
Get it all the time. Do you see it, Javi? Come on.
You know, I see a little bit.
How about Ben Affleck? Do I get Ben Affleck? Marsha texted me last night during the donut commercial, says, hey, I thought I saw Feeney, Ben.
Yo, you can buy all that. You can buy all that stuff.
Right?
You can buy that thing, that Dunkin' Donuts thing he was wearing. You can buy it. You go.
I'm going to get one.
Halloween, and see, it's all you. Do it.
And then I was at Elmwood Pastry yesterday, and some guy, older gentleman, looked at me and goes, you look like Coach Shanahan from the Niners. So I had a great day.
That's amazing.
Shanahan, Ben Affleck, I think more Levine.
If I had to choose the out of the three, I would, yes, sure. I would say that.
Yes.
Here's to the ones that we got. Sorry.
And let's break in a song. Who wants to hear Javi sing a song?
Can I sing? What do you want me to sing, Eric? Y'all let you tell me. What do you want me to sing?
Should we hear the song that won him the Voice, or?
We start with that one. Or you want to end with that one?
Start
with that one. Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, it's fine.
What do you think?
Start with it.
Okay.
We're starting with it. All right. So this is the song that I say changed my life. Sang this song in front of those four coaches. Christine Aguilera, Blake Shelton, CeeLo Green, Adam Levine. I had no idea what was going to happen. I knew that I needed something to happen in my life if I was going to continue in music. And I was all worked up about it. And right before I went out there, I realized, I said, you know what? There's only certain things you can control. I can control what I play on the guitar. I can control what comes out of my mouth. But the rest is not up to me. Those four coaches, I can't make them like me. I can't make them press their button. And when I thought of it that way, it was very freeing to me, because I was like, you know what? I can't do anything about that. I can only do what I can do. So do what you do as best as you can, and the rest is going to fall where it does. And
what made you pick that song?
You know what? I had just started playing that song maybe less than a year before, and it just was a song that I had always loved, but I did a slower version of it, and people seemed to like it when I would play it in some of the college shows and the things that I was doing. So I decided to play that, and they allowed me to play that, because you have to kind of get permission from them to play the songs that you want to play. So, and they allowed me to sing it. So yeah, I was lucky that I got to sing it. But yeah, this is the song that changed my life. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Man. Oh. I'm feeling it too.
Yeah. Listen, don't. If you start, I'm going to be a blubbering mess. I cannot. Listen, my heart literally is like right under here.
Okay.
And if you start crying, I have no chance.
Okay.
I'll be a puddle on the floor.
I didn't know you that well. I would have let him go.
You're right.
I was there. I held back.
Yeah.
My girls are here. My wife's here.
I know. Yes. Let's
go. I got
you
here.
Listen,
that was absolutely beautiful and amazing. And I'm right here, and I heard it, and I was like,
thank you.
Time after time, it's great.
Thank you. Time after time. And you know what? And that's a great song for this event, because you are here You and the friends of Feeney are here for our community time again and time after time after time, serving our community. So we thank you for that.
Thank you.
It's a perfect song for
you. Thank you.
So let's talk about these 40,000 listeners a month on Spotify.
Do I have that? Is that what I have?
40,000 a month.
Is that good? That's good. I mean, I think so. I mean,
it's that's not, good.
It's not Taylor Swift numbers.
I think Friends of Feeney has 4 listeners a month.
Well, listen, every listener that I have, I appreciate. You know, during the pandemic, I did this series from my living room, where I did think we did like 16 Saturdays in a row, where I just did, you know, just a, you know, I forgot what I even called it. Quarantine. It was Javier Colon quarantine concert series. And
kitchen karaoke?
Well, we did some kitchen karaoke, but that was different. But yeah, so I did, so every Saturday, I would do like this 2-hour show. You know, I think we started like a couple weeks into the pandemic, and I just, you know, no one had anything to do. And, you know, us musicians were the same. We were sitting at home and we wanted to play for people. We wanted to perform for folks, but we couldn't leave. Literally couldn't, you know, get tackled if you go to the grocery store. So I started doing the series, and something that I loved was I got to connect with my fan base so much more than I had before, because I would sing a song and then I'd look at the comments and I'd get to like answer people's questions, and just, you know, it was really... It really meant a lot. And then I found out afterwards, as I've been traveling around again, how much it meant to other folks to have that time. And it was also a time when my daughters started singing with me more, because it was less daunting, because there wasn't an audience that they could see, you know. So they would just come and sit with me by the piano, and they started doing the singing. And now, you know, my daughter has one of the leads in the Cantor musical Les Mis this next month. Super stoked for her. My other daughter is also in the ensemble. So, you know, it's, you know, I'm trying to raise some musicians in the house, and everybody's, you know, it's a blessing. It's a blessing to have had that time with my family. You know, to be able to nurture that bug, you know, of music in them. You know, if there was a silver lining for me in that whole pandemic, I know there was so many horrible things that happened. There, you know, the fact that I didn't travel for 13 months, which means I got to kiss my kids. Whew, it made me cry. I'm gonna make me cry. I got to kiss my kids goodnight every night for 13 months, which is something I never got to do before. So that was awesome. And that part of it. And also my father was ill, and I would go to his house every night to help set up his dialysis machine. And as much as sometimes I didn't, I was like, oh man, I, you know, it was kind of a, it felt like a chore at times. I look back at that and I'm so grateful that I had that time, because I lost him a couple of years ago. So it's, yeah. Crazy, we're getting deep here, dude. Friends of Feeney. Sorry. Sorry. And
then, yeah.
Thank you.
The national anthem has always been a favorite, and you sung it at the Bills Dolphins. In the Orange Bowl, Clemson,
yep.
West Virginia.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite time of singing the national anthem, or one that sticks out?
I do.
And what does it mean to you?
I love singing the anthem. It is the hardest song on the planet to sing. People say that all the time, but let me tell you, it is the hardest song to sing. First of all, we don't speak like that anymore. We don't say, oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming. Like, if you, it's literally just has to be muscle memory, because if you forget a line, like, there's no logical lead-in to the next line. It's just, like, you just have to know it, and it's hard. And if you get distracted, or, like, a bug flies by, like, you just literally, it could all go away, and you're like, you know? So I like when someone messes it up, I always like I tweet them and I send them all the love that I can, because I know that it's a horrible, horrible feeling, and it could happen to any of us. So but I do love the song, but that it is the hardest song. But my favorite time ever doing it, I have to say, was the anthem. I was asked to do the Thanksgiving night game. It was 49ers Seahawks back in 2014, I want to say. I was 14 or 13, somewhere in there. And it was going to be the most televised one I had ever done because it was Thanksgiving night. It was, I think, 21 million people watching at home, 76,000 people in Levi Stadium. And it was daunting. But I figured out a trick. So, you know, sometimes a lot of it, like, you know, when you're performing, you have to fake it. Like, I could be nervous as anything, but you have to fake it. You got to pretend like you're not nervous. And that's one of the things I told myself before I went out on that stage on The Voice. I said, listen, those four people are superstars. When they're on stage, they don't look nervous. They look like they're having fun. So that's what you have to do. Like, you have to go out there. As nervous as I was, and even though I had had record deals and, like, you know, I had performed a bunch, like, I was just, I knew that this meant a lot, and I was nervous. But I said, listen, just go out there and just be yourself, have fun, and don't think about them. Just have fun. So anyway, that's, I ended up, for this performance, I put a GoPro on the end of my guitar, and I had the plans of, you know, putting it on YouTube, which I ended up doing. But so I was basically playing to my camera. I was like, so if I'm going to post this, I can't look nervous because that would be stupid. Why would I post that? So I have to, like, look like I'm cool. I'm like, I'm having fun. I'm like, this is not a thing. So the camera was going, and I just, it was kind of a cool angle because it was at the end of my guitar. And that was kind of how I kept my mind off of being nervous, is that I was pretending, because I was like, I got to post a cool video, and this is going to have to be a cool, you know. So that's how I got through that one. Yeah. But I like that one. It's fun.
LaTanya and I talked about the national anthem on 99.
Yes.
Which reminds me, take out your phones and follow, you know, Friends of Feeney on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, and then also follow Feeney Talks with Friends. We got to up these followers. You guys are here,
yes.
So thank you.
And follow me too if you don't mind. I mean, if that's okay.
You're already following Javier Colon.
Not necessarily.
And so, hat or no hat?
What do you mean?
You're always wearing a hat.
I am. I do.
Why?
I'm a hat guy. Why? I don't know when it started. I think it started with my first record deal, where we're just looking for cool things to do, and I just was like an accessory guy. I liked hats, and I started wearing hats. Like, even like, so for every performance I did, I would always have some kind of hat, and then it changed to baseball caps specifically, with a slight tilt, not too far, but just a little bit.
Crunk, we call that crunk.
You call it crunk. I don't know what I call it.
You got crunk the hat.
I just call it slightly tilted. But you can call it whatever you want. That's fine. That started. When I got my deal in 03, and I've been doing it ever since. There was one time the coaches and the producers were giving me a hard time about the hat on The Voice, because it was hard to light me, and they, like, it would just make them mad that I had a hat on all the time. So they had to, like, you know, they just. It pissed them off a little bit. So I basically, there was a performance I was doing of a song that I thought you might want me to sing there. And I actually took my hat off and I threw it into the audience. I knew I was gonna do it, but they didn't know I was gonna do it. So they didn't actually have a camera catch me, like, actually throwing it. They were mad at me that I didn't tell them that I was gonna do that. But I was like, it was supposed to be a surprise, and it was. So. So the hats, it's been a thing. You know, I have no crazy scars or anything on my head or anything. So it's not,
And you play left-handed and right-handed, or?
Just lefty.
How's it being lefty guitaric? Guitarist?
It's cool. I'm fortunate to have a relationship with my guitar company, because they made this guitar for me. I've got my logo here and there. It's kind of a one of a kind, which I'm so grateful for, because I can't go to Guitar Center and pick up a really, really good instrument. As far as lefties go, there's usually one or two, and they're usually like the entry level guitar. So that's the only downfall to being lefty, is that I can't just go somewhere and pick up a guitar. Because I can pick it up, but it's going to be right-handed most of the time, and that's not that's not as fun.
Do you golf lefty too?
I golf lefty. Badly, but yes, I do.
I'm gone.
Yeah. These days, badly. Anyway.
Let's talk about that cool little golf cart that you have.
Oh, yeah. A company named Fat Scooter made me this awesome voice golf cart. It's kind of like a golf scooter, and you put your clubs on the back of it, and I ride it from my house on Fern Street over to the golf course, and you can see me with my helmet on, and I'm playing some tunes, and you see the golf clubs in the back, you see me at a stoplight, I've gotten so many people like, yeah, that's amazing! Thank you. And then I take it right to the golf course, and I ride it. I can ride it on the golf course, and it's actually a golf cart. So I get off of it, hit the ball, and I get back on, and whoa, it makes no noise because it's electric. But I did that because it's fun.
When are we gonna golf together?
When are we gonna golf together? As soon as it's warm, let's go.
All right,
I'm in.
We're in.
I'm down.
Need two more.
Two more.
Mark.
You got Moriarty in there. Let's go.
Fresh tea. First tea.
Let's go.
We're gonna raffle it off. Ooh, we're raffling that off. Yo.
Let's go.
See how that works? We think of things. 99, we got her.
Sorry.
Raffle. Going once, 500. Going once, 1,000. I heard 1,000.
Let's do it.
So you were gonna play the song where you threw your hat? I think that's the song that I wanna dedicate to my wife.
I think that might have been the one. Is that the one you sent me? There she is.
I dedicate this to you. I love you. I won't sing, I promise.
It's the one we talked about, right? The one from the Coldplay. Making sure I don't sing the wrong song.
When you try your best, but you don't succeed. When you get what you want, not what you need. When you feel so tired, but you can't sleep. Stuck in reverse. When the tears come streaming down your face. When you lose some. Can't replace when you love someone, but it goes to waste. Could it be worse? Lights will guide you home. Stream down your face when you lose something you cannot replace. Tears stream down your face, and tears stream down your.
Thank you. Thank you. A couple more questions and you'll do one more?
Yeah.
Okay. A couple more questions.
Of course. No worries.
So you played with the Boston Symphony Orchestra and you also played with Adam Levine. And you talk about which one was better and why.
Oh, goodness. Oh, man. Listen, that's not fair.
Tough spot.
Listen, so both were incredible opportunities. I got to tour with Maroon 5. And I think, if I have to choose one, if I don't want to choose one, they're both amazing for different reasons. But I had the most amazing experience opening up for Maroon 5. I convinced Adam to let me go to open up their South American tour in 2012. We started in Mexico. Then we went to South America. And we did three shows in Mexico. Then we did Chile, Paraguay. Chile, Paraguay, Argentina, Brazil, three shows in Brazil, and Peru. It was phenomenal. And I convinced it because I speak Spanish. I said, listen, so you need somebody to open up for you that actually like can sing in Spanish because you're going to come on. I was like, come on, this is a no-brainer. This is me. I warm them up, I'll speak in their native tongue, and when you come out, it's just going to be amazing. And he was like, okay, let's do it. I was like, really? He's like, yeah. it was amazing. So my favorite show ever that I'll never forget, I legit got off the stage and I bawled my eyes out. And my whole band like did the same thing because we couldn't believe it. We were in Sao Paulo, Brazil. We were performing for about 40,000 people. And it's weird being the opener for folks because sometimes this whole tour, I expected that like when the lights go down and then the opener comes out, everybody's going to be disappointed because they're expecting the band that they paid money to see. You know what I mean? But every single time I went out there, I was wrong. They just showed us so much love in Latin America. It was unbelievable. And in Sao Paulo, there was a moment where I was singing one of my songs and the audience started singing it back to me. And like, I looked back at my guitarist, like with like a tear was about to fall from my face. I was like, this can't be happening. I'm like, how is this happening? And they sang like the whole song. They sang this chorus part that we taught him in the beginning. They just kind of knew where to put it. It was amazing, and I'll never forget it. And I'm looking back at my band the whole time, like this is what it's like. This must be what it's like to like reach that level. Like, you know, and like even though we knew that it was only for this moment, but it just felt like we had gotten there in that moment. It was phenomenal. So that was probably my favorite with my band ever, getting to get up there and sing my own songs and other people's songs too, but getting to sing some of my own songs. But the Boston Symphony thing was on another level as well, because I got to sing with the entire orchestra, not only just any orchestra, but the Boston Symphony, which is just a world renowned, arguably the best orchestra on the planet. And to get to do that, and to do that in front of like, 300,000 people or so that were all gathered by the Charles River to do it on the 4th of July. It was a very, very special moment for me as well. I wouldn't trade either of them for sure. Yeah.
Then one quick question, and then you'll play an encore, and then we're going to go on to our next guest. But this was an amazing chat. I'm so happy that you're here.
Awesome to chat with you, man.
Can you, I always wanted to do that, thought it was super cool. Can you talk to me and talk to the band and hit the notes at the same time? Like, hey, I like to thank everybody for coming, and that's like always the coolest thing. Can you hit him with a little?
You know what, you just start talking, and I'll just play some stuff underneath you. Go ahead.
All right, let's try it. So we're here at the 100th podcast. Playhouse on Park. I'm speaking here with Javier Colon. He's a famous singer and songwriter. I'm just amazed that everyone's here. I'm surrounded by so many friends.
How's that?
That was awesome.
Yeah. Sometimes it does distract me when I'm playing. and try to talk at the same time. So sometimes I stop, but there are times where I'll noodle. I'll play like Stairway to Heaven or something while I'm
be here 17 minutes later.
But yeah, it is fun sometimes to noodle it. And like, as you're kind of introducing a song to just, you know, to introduce a song and just be playing with chords as you're talking. But you don't really know how hard I'm thinking about doing full fate at the same time. I got to take a pause every now and then just to be like, it's core, okay. All right. But yeah, but I try to hide it, try to fake it. Fake it till you make it.
Cool. Will you rock the hat on a show or a song?
Let's do it.
Take it on tour? And then will you also, we're going to do that raffle, foursome.
Foursome, let's go.
Give it up for Javi, and he's going to take us away with a song. He's going to do a song. I'm going to chat with my next guest.
We're going to do one more.
One more.
Okay, one last one. All right, I'll do one last one. This one,
I'm gonna get my nap.
It's a song that
oh yeah, boom.
That I love to sing. You've heard it a million times. It's the last song on my last record. I did it just like this, just from acoustic,
just me and my guitar. And I hope you like it. I dedicate this to all of you all.
Well, I heard there was a secret chord, and David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do ya? Well, it goes like this, the fourth and the fifth, the minor fall and the major lift. Baffled King composing, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. This room and I've walked this floor. You know, I used to live alone before I knew you. I've seen your flag on the marble arch. Love is not a victory march, it's a cold and it's a broken. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Maybe there's a God above, all I've ever learned from love is how to shoot somebody who wound you up. It's not a cry that you hear at night. It's not somebody you've seen the light. It's a coldness of broken. Ooh. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you guys so much. Thank you, Eric.
We always end every podcast saying, be a good friend on three. So just say one, two, three, be a good friend. Yo, that was awesome.
Thank you guys.
Give it up.
Let me hear you.
Yes. All right, sing it with me, people.
Why can't we be friends? Why can't we be friends? Why can't we be friends? Why can't we be friends?
What we got, Feeney? Who's next?
Yo, so just before we close out, the raffle. Last call for the raffle. Go ahead and get your raffle tickets. Raffle tickets, see Jen. Last call for raffle.
Last call for raffle. Is that what we're doing right now, Feeney?
And then, give it up. And we have our second guest, Frank Whaley. Ladies and gentlemen, director, actor, just an amazing human being.
did you ever consider bringing me out first?
Yeah, I should have.
I mean, the guy sings like an angel, and now they got me. The guy sings Cyndi Lauper and Coldplay like a freaking angel, and now they're like, who's this guy? Is he gonna sing? Where is he from? Why are we paying money to see this?
Rookie move. But you're Frank.
I mean, that guy's amazing.
Yeah. I was never on The Voice. I have a horrible shrill voice. That's all I got.
However, you did shoot Jack Nicholson and Danny DeVito. How did that feel?
Still, you should have bought me on. You're referring to a film, of course.
and it felt bad because, I don't know, probably none of these people have seen that film. But for those who have, this will be an interesting story. In the scene where I shoot Jack Nicholson, he was very displeased with me because my very first film that I ever was in was called Ironweed, where I played Jack Nicholson as a young man in flashback. I was 23, and the character I was playing was 14. I had a very young-looking face at that time. That was before I smoked many, 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 many cigarettes and drank more wine than yes, you can imagine. But in Ironweed, Jack Nicholson hated my performance as young him, and he wanted to put his voice over my voice. That's how much he hated my performance.
Wow, good old Jack.
albeit I was brilliant in that picture, so I'm not sure what his problem was. But, so when I showed up on the set years later on this set, he was very unhappy to see me. And he was sitting in the chair reading the New York Times, and they brought me in to introduce him and say, Jack, this is Frank. He's going to be playing so-and-so. And he looked up from the newspaper and said, you again. So that inspired a lot of confidence. my performance. But anyway, when I was going to shoot him, to add insult to injury, he wanted to be at the Chicago Bulls game. Somehow that was my fault that we were running late. So the gun that I was shooting at him had a blank cartridge in it. And that when I fired the gun, the cartridge ricocheted off of the back of the car and hit me in the side of the face. And so that inspired even more confidence in my performance. Later that day, I was in my trailer, in my room, I wouldn't call it a trailer. It was a small room with it, that I shared with some Germans. I have no idea. And they knocked on the door, told me to come to set, and the room was situated in the back of this, like in the back of this restaurant where you're filming, and I was eager to get there because they were running behind, and I ran, and I didn't see because it was kind of a wooded area. There was a 2x4 on a scaffold, and I ran right into the 2x4. And my right eye hit the 2x4, and I fell back on the ground. So I had this big cut on my face that they covered up from the shrapnel, and I had this eye that looked like I had been punched by Mike Tyson. And I went into the makeup room to get it fixed, and Jack Nicholson was sitting in there. And he said, "Hey, you found a way to f*** it up again." Have they been here the whole time?
So I feel like you're either holding a cigarette or a gun in these movies, or both. What do you think? What was the prop the most? Cigarettes or guns?
In that movie?
Just movers. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, cigarettes and guns have been a big part of my life since my early childhood. it's really the only thing that I know really well.
You either play a bad guy.
When my father would pistol at me, he was always smoking. When my mother was smoking, she was always pistol at me. So we had it all. People are out there, "I don't understand. Where's his guitar? Why is he not singing?"
You did.
$27 we paid for this goddamn thing. This guy's talking.
You did write "Come On Baby, Light My Fire" in the movie.
Yes, I believe the title. You're an expert researcher, but I believe the title is "Light My Fire." "Come On Baby" is in the song. Yes.
How Irish are you?
How Irish?
Yeah.
Half Irish.
Okay.
Yes.
It's showing right now.
Thank you.
How much from Syracuse are you?
I am from Syracuse.
Okay, yes. Keep going.
100%. 100% from Syracuse, or as we used to call it, Sorry Case. not a happy town.
Light My Fire.
Yes. It was written by Robbie Krieger. And but I played Robbie Krieger in The Doors, if that's what you're getting around to. I did play that part.
What about...
Maybe Javier would like to come out and sing it. The man has the voice of an angel. He should have been on instead of Usher.
Ooh, yeah. Yeah. Okay.
With all due respect to Usher, of course. And all Ushers around the world.
So you either play it.
I was in a movie with Usher. Can you name
it? Ooh. Anybody? He was in a movie with Usher.
If anybody here knows the movie that I was in with Usher, I will personally write a check for $75.
No phones.
And Javier will sing it.
Oh, sing it. Clue.
Trick question. I was in a movie. So y'all know. No, it was called Hustlers.
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 Hustles?
Hustlers.
Hustlers.
No, Hustler. Singular. With J-Lo.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So did you play a bad guy? A cop?
Yes.
Or a bad cop?
A bad cop. And she waved her booty in my face for 3 days.
That's another thing. Bad guy, cop, or bad cop?
Yeah.
Which one's your favorite to play?
Probably Bad Cop. it's fun, and there's a lot of them to emulate. With all due respect to the police force, it was a joke. West Hartford has the best police department in the United States.
Police Chief was on Feeney Talks with Friends. Go back and watch that podcast. Chief Riddick.
And the mayor was here, right?
Mayor Shari Cantor.
She did a flip.
She did
when
the cartwheel.
That was an impeachable offense. The mayor of Syracuse was impeached for doing cartwheels.
Come on.
That's true. That's true. Crazy.
Thankfully, she left.
Well, she heard Hallelujah, and she hauled. Frank, who? No, thank you. I just did a goddamn cartwheel.
So, did you really roller skate around Target with Jennifer Connelly?
Yes, I did.
No stunt doubles.
I think there was a stunt double at one point, but I was, you know, when I was a kid, I used to go roller skating all the time. That was the way I found all the chicks.
Roller Magic in Waterbury was the spot.
Yeah, we used to go to
Roller Magic.
Yeah, we used to go to, what was it called? I forget the name of it. It was in Mattydale, New York. We would hitchhike because it was a long ways away, but we would go every Saturday night. Open skates, 7 to 11, $2.50. Nice. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So tell us about your first lead role, right? Was that the career opportunities with Jennifer Connelly?
That was probably my first lead role. From where I came from, I was so broke all the time that I had the inability to say no to anything. So even though I'd done my first film with Jack Nicholson and Meryl Streep, then they offered me a Hallmark commercial. And my agent said, well, you probably shouldn't do that. You're doing what? No, because I didn't want to leave the money out on the table. So I did that, and I did ABC After School Special.
Yeah.
CBS School Break Special. I did them all. Every After School Special. So those were lead roles, I guess. I did, and I was on the original Equalizer.
Okay.
With what's his name?
Not Denzel.
No, this was the TV
Robert
show.
Woodward. Robert Woodward. Trivia guy. That's, good luck.
That.
Robert Woodward.
Edward Woodward. That's right. Yes. And I did Spencer for Hire. That one, yeah, did that one with who can name that guy? Spencer Byer.
Robert Ulrich.
Who?
Robert Ulrich.
Phone a friend. Chris Conway's your guy.
anyway, all I can remember is he had a real bad intestinal problem. That was my takeaway. I called him the fart blossom. But he was a great guy. But anyway, I had done all these things in between, my first film, and then I did, I don't know how I got that part. I did a movie called Cold Dog Soup, which is probably the worst film ever made. I think that was before Career Opportunities, and that was with Randy Quaid, and I don't remember who else, but it was all...
Oh, yeah, super weird. I saw the clip.
Yeah, it's a very strange film.
You're driving through the car.
Yeah, and it's all about a guy who goes on a date with this young lady. He goes to her house, and during dinner, her dog dies. And so she says, you have to take this dog and bury him, and if you do, when you come back, I will have sexual intercourse with you.
So you did what you had to do.
I didn't write this story. I didn't conceive of this plot. This was given to me, and because I was incapable of saying no to anything, I said, this sounds like a great idea. And there I was, running around for 4 months with a dead dog and Randy Quaid, who was so drunk off his ass, I couldn't even believe it.
Great.
I'd seen some pretty drunk people in my background.
He was great in Cousin Eddie, though.
Yeah, I'll take your word for it.
All right. This has been, we need to know, and I think you're the guy.
Yeah.
Who was the voice in Field of Dreams? Because in the credits it says himself. Who's the voice?
I'm not familiar with that film. I have no idea.
Field of Dreams.
Yeah, no, yes.
Archie?
I'm familiar with it. But I'm not sure who that, that's a good question. I've never even thought, I've never heard
that. They said it was Ed Harris. Anybody heard Ed Harris? Well, that's my father-in-law, and that's his favorite movie. That's my father-in-law.
Congratulations.
He let me marry my wife. After many threats.
He let you marry him.
Yeah. But he's never been to my podcast. He's never listened to my podcast. He barely likes me. He calls me Derek. But he's here for you. I'm kidding, Pop.
I appreciate it. I guarantee on the way home, he's going to be like, if I had any idea he was such a smartass, I never would watch him. Never watch him. Crap. No, thank you very much. I appreciate that. I didn't know it was Ed Harris, but that makes sense because Ed Harris is married to Amy Madigan, who plays Kevin Costner's wife in that.
You got it there, folks. I solved the mystery. That's for real, Dean, too. I'll make things up, but that's real.
But that didn't stop her from, touching little Frankie all over the place. Someone just said, oh my God! For the record, that is horrible. For the record, it's not true.
Number 100.
Just like somewhere in Calabasas, just like, somebody's talking about me. They're telling lies. So Madigan was a complete sweetheart. Never laid a hand on me.
Seeing that Field of Dreams is a sports movie, you got to sit, start, and bench. Costner.
Yes.
James Earl Jones. Ray Liotta. Who are you going to start, sit, or bench?
Well, I would say James Earl, start. Yeah. He's the greatest. Yeah. In fact, James Earl was in one of his after-school specials with me. That's true. It's called Soldier Boys. Look it up. It was about a bunch of survivalists. Wow. Yeah, brilliant. James Earl is amazing. He's such an amazing guy. And Liotta and I were really, we were inseparably close during the course of that film. And he's a great guy and great actor. Costner, is that my playoff music?
The hook.
You're playing me off the butt.
Oh, that was fun, Frank.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I want to thank my legal team. But Costner and I didn't see eye to eye. Shock. He didn't get my sense of humor. Unlike everybody else here. Where we were situated, our dressing rooms was like a mile and a half away from the baseball field where we were filming. So in order to keep the wide shots, keep all that stuff out of the wide shots, the trucks and stuff. They would give us golf carts to drive, when they called us a set to drive over. And I was, it's hard to imagine, but I was like, kind of a wise ass in those days. I know it's hard
to not you.
And Costner didn't like it. But so they called me to the set, and my room, I came down the stairs of my room, jumped in this golf cart, and usually what I do is just whip around the front of the truck. But what I didn't realize is that they had parked another truck there, which I didn't anticipate whatsoever. No way I could have known. It was a camera truck. And I was kind of looking down, and when I looked up, my eyes widened, and I slammed into the side of this trailer, this camera truck, and put a huge dent in this brand new camera truck. And if you know anything about Teamsters, they don't like it when a guy smashes into the truck with a golf cart and then says, what's the big deal? They want a little remorse. And so the Teamsters want to kick my ass, everybody turned against me. Nobody liked me anymore, and I had to be there for another 2 months. But Liotta got it, and James Joe said, don't worry about it, kid, it can be fine. That was a horrible James. Javier?
Well, like Javier, Shoeless Joe Jackson was a lefty.
Uh-huh.
But Ray Liotta batted him as a righty in the movie. Huge flaw.
Wow.
People are mad about it. I'm still not over it. How do you feel about it?
Well, Leota's dead now and can't really speak for himself. So. I didn't have, I know, again, another piece of trivia. I had no idea. Wow. Yeah.
Stick around, folks. Yeah. Chris Conway, write that down.
That's amazing. I'm sure it wasn't the only mistake Leota made in his life.
So you didn't know the voice, but do you know what is in Marcellus Wallace's suitcase? What's in the suitcase? Lights up gold.
It's either the soul of Marcellus Wallace or a movie light with like a gel over it. One of the other.
Any thoughts? What do you think's in the case? Anyone know? Heard anything? Someone said drugs. They thought it was the soul because Marcellus Wallace has a Band-Aid on the back of his neck. So that's where the soul came from to put it in the suitcase.
Yes.
I don't know. What do you think?
I think you're probably right. It's probably Marcellus Wallace's soul.
I haven't been wrong all night, except for singing, dancing, and a couple facts.
Yeah.
All right, so you were in four best pictures.
Yes.
Can you name them?
Well, I know Pulp Fiction. You mean nominated or actually?
Nominated.
Nominated. Pulp Fiction, Field of Dreams, Cold Dog Soup. And the theatrical release of Soldier Boy's ABC After the Special. There's such a popular demand for that, they've made it into a feature film, just with just coverage of, you know, footage of James Earl doing everything conceivably possible. I think it was one of the 4th of July, right?
Yep.
And I don't know.
President one.
Which one?
President.
JFK. Yes, that's right. Yes. So, I'm off.
Do you have a favorite?
Didn't win the Voice. Was never on the Voice.
The Voice is his favorite. So good. So you didn't know the box, the Voice.
Right.
Who shot JFK? Did Oliver Stone tell you?
Well, it wasn't Lee Harvey Oswald.
I agree.
But I did. I was. I'll tell you a funny thing. It's actually not funny, but
fun fact.
But I was actually offered the role of Lee Harvey Oswald in JFK, and then unceremoniously uncast in that film. And I found out the way I found out was in the old days when you went to the movies, they would like put out these catalogs with like movie news, and I read that. What's his name, was going to play JFK, or going to play Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yep.
I was seeing Cliffhanger with...
Cliffhanger? Rocky?
Yeah. Cliffhanger is the porn. a few years later, I was given the role of Lee Harvey Oswald in a film, somewhat lesser film, called... Fatal Deception, Mrs. Lee Harvey Oswald. Where I played Mrs. Lee Harvey Oswald. No. Lee Harvey Oswald's wife, her name escapes me, was played by Helena Bonham Carter, and I played Lee Harvey Oswald.
And,
yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, she was nominated for Golden Globe. I was nominated for
Super Bowl was last night. If you could pick a commercial and promote or advertise anything you want, money's not an option. You get a 30-second commercial. What are you promoting?
That's a hell of a good question.
Marsha.
Thank you for stealing my thunder. I was going to say Trojan condoms. Because I believe in birth control. Period, the end. And that's my charity.
Woo. It's getting hot up here.
I regret saying that because there are children in the house. Guys?
Yeah. Uncle Frank.
Disregard what Uncle Frank just said about Trojan condoms. And you too, mother-in-law. My wife, somewhere. I used to have a wife here. There she is.
Oh.
She was a mail order bride, but we've been getting along really well. She's She's from the Czech Republic.
No.
She's great. She's fantastic. She speaks four words of English. Where is my checkbook?
Yes. Oh.
It's technically five words.
How about your checkbook? Your father-in-law?
Yes.
Paul Buca.
Yeah.
Podcast guest. Go
Please
back and check
he's
it out.
Not here.
Medal of Honor recipient, International Hall of Fame swimmer.
Amazing. Amazing.
West Point grad. Amazing. Go back and check out that podcast. He was on a podcast too.
Let's wait till my podcast is over to start to, you know, to talk about others. When he comes on, you can talk about my podcast.
Deal.
No, but no, he's an American hero, and you know, I consider myself to be one as well because I played many heroes in movies. I play soldiers, I play policemen, I play medics. It's not quite the same, but...
True.
No, he's an amazing guy, and, you know, we love him dearly.
Yeah, he's
Unlike
great.
My father, who was a dead drunk janitor from Syracuse. He didn't win any medals of honor, I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, smoked cigarettes and pistol whipped you.
Yes.
I stole that. Who said that? I stole it.
No purple hearts for old Robert Whaley.
Swimming with sharks, you beat the snot out of Kevin Spacey. How'd that feel?
Felt good at the time and afterward.
Better now.
Yes, he's as advertised, Kevin Spacey. Put it that way. Look, you want a straight talk.
And Swing Kids, you played someone with a disability.
Yes, I did.
Went into that role, study, practice.
Well. That's I'll say about Swing Kids, that's the best movie Disney ever made about dancing Nazis. I'll say that one. And here's a funny story about the disability. So I did read the script, and I'd forgotten a lot of it by the time the movie came to shoot, because I'm supposed to be like, you know, a guy with like a wooden leg, I think, as I recall, right? Mm-hmm. And the first scene up, the first scene that I was in, we were supposed to cross a bridge. It was myself, Christian Bale, and Robert Shorten Leonard. And we were standing, talking, having a great time. You know, we're in our period outfits and, you know, our hats and all that stuff. And the director said, action, and we're supposed to walk across this bridge. And so he said, action, and I went like this. And so then there was a lot of discussion. And we were standing around because the camera was quite a distance away, and we were like, I wonder what they're talking about there. It's just so weird. It's just a bunch of guys walking across the bridge. And then the director said, we got to go again, because he was on a bullhorn, because he was far away. He said, Frank, you're supposed to be limping. And so I said, yeah, that was it. You want more? I don't want to go over the top with this limp thing, man. So, yeah, there's my story for this one. Thank you very much.
So, we have sponsors. West Hartford Lock, are they still here? West Hartford Lock. Three keys that you would say that a great actor needs. What are three characteristics? Three keys that make a great actor.
Okay. I would say famous parents.
One.
Really tall.
Wow. You're 0 for 2.
And really, how dare you? Famous parents, really tall and really good looking.
Should I say it?
Oh, 4-3. You don't need to tell me. I look in the mirror every day. I got. It's like my mother used to say. You got a face for radio, kid.
Oh.
And that was her showing me love.
This is great. This is like the Jimmy Show.
Ah.
You are hilarious.
Thank you.
You played a stand-up comic. You are being a stand-up comedian right now. I didn't know what to expect, but I'm having an amazing time talking with you.
Appreciate that.
I really appreciate you taking the time.
My pleasure.
Give it up again for
and
Frank
thank
Whaley.
You for everything you do.
Well, we're not done yet. We're not done yet. We're not. We're just getting into the good stuff. Who do you like better, Jon Voight or Marlon Brando? Follow-up questions. These are good.
I've slept with them both. Different periods of my life. I was in a different headspace with Marlon. Jon was much more gentle. Marlon was very heavy at the time. We had to take that into consideration. Brando, I had different experiences with the film. Jon Voight, I was in, I don't remember the season I did of Ray Donovan, but I was on the show Ray Donovan for a season. Boy, I bet you got a fish for compliments around here.
tough crowd.
But for those of you who are still awake, Jon Voight and I were in many scenes together. He's a very strange fellow. He's, you know, with all due respect to everybody, his politics are very right-wing. Mine are not so much right-wing. I don't talk about politics when I go to work. All I want to do is eat donuts, lie down, and then, you know, do what I'm supposed to do. That's all I want. But he was continually talking about politics, sort of goading people into it. I don't know if this had anything to do with it, but one, we were doing a scene, and our characters have somewhat of an antagonistic relationship in the show. And it was in this like small space. It was a set they built. It was like a public restroom. And I'm supposed to say a few lines to him and you know, sort of get very emotional, get face to face with him and tell him, you know, you're going to do this and you're going to do that and you're going to do that. And that's how it is. Because, you know, because I play like an FBI guy and he's an informant. So in the beginning of the scene, I decided that I would floss my teeth in the mirror. And which I thought was a brilliant choice, not only because my teeth needed flossing, and I didn't want to look at him when he was talking. And he didn't like that, I think. And so when I turned around to him and started yelling at him, he suddenly, without warning, and this was after two or three rehearsals where everything was fine, and we had the scene, we were ready to go, and the director said, action. Out of nowhere, out of the blue, without any warning, Jon Voight is like 6'5", 275 pounds. Me, I'm like 5'2", I weigh 78 pounds. Man reared back his hand and slapped me so hard across the face that I flew like from here to the end of this stage. And like a fish that somebody threw out of a boat. Like a kitten that somebody threw down the highway. You understand what I'm saying?
We get it.
Like a bag of potatoes. And everybody went silent. Nobody said a word. The cameras kept rolling. And I just looked up at him and just said quietly, why? Why? And he said, I didn't hurt you. And then they had to bring me back into the makeup room to get the shame and the off my face. But
that's terrible.
Yeah, that was awful. That was awful. And
did he ask you what the five fingers say to the face first, or
no? No, he didn't. Horrible posture.
Oh, it's tough, isn't it? Oh.
But with Marlon Brando, the story I have with Marlon Brando, which you're probably referring to, is Marlon Brando. On the film I did called The Freshman with Marlon Brando and Matthew Broderick, great Bruno Kirby. He ordered no photos of him being taken on the set at all. And one of my good friends was the still photographer on the set. But he was not allowed to shoot Marlon unless it was pre-set and pre-set up. It was my last day of filming. I really wanted a photo with Marlon Brando. And so I said, look, I'm just gonna stand next to him and just go over there. And this is a good friend of mine. We were in college together. And I said, just take a picture, just one picture, you know, and I'll take you out for dinner. And he said, So he took the picture and it was fine. The next day, I came to work and it was a different guy on the set, a different still photographer on the set. And I said, where's Mark? And they said, yeah, he was fired. Ooh. Because he took a picture of Marlon Brando. And I said, what asshole asked me to do? What kind of a jerk would break the rules? There's always got to be somebody that needs a picture with Marlon Brando, and now he's fired and he has a family. God damn it. But he did send me the picture, because I called him and said, could you please send me that picture? Because that's the kind of a man that I am. Just, you can ask my wife. She knows.
Oh, sweating up here. Whew. TV shows, Psych or Law & Order? You were on both.
Well, I've been on all of the Law & Orders like four times. I've sat in the same courtroom set on the original Law & Order three times. In the same spot. Playing a pedophile every time. They keep bringing me back. We need a really bad pet Frank Whaley. He's already played a pedophile on the show. Frank Whaley, get him. He's a pedophile. Bring him in. But Psych was fun. I like those guys. And that episode of Psych, I get stopped all the time by people who either think that I'm their, like, you know, classmate from high school, or I know you from somewhere, and then I've got to go through like 45 credits. No, not that one. I don't know, lady. But Psych is something that I'm recognized for a lot. That's a very popular show. Yes.
Yeah, of all shows.
Got
too.
Paid $7,000, getting not a penny in residuals. Thank you very much, Screen Actors. We played that thing 58 times a day. Not a penny for Frank. Got to take my wife to Target for her clothes. And it shows. Just look at it. All due respect.
And
H&M before splurging.
Joe the King.
Yes.
Who's that about?
Joe the King is it's a semi-autobiographical film that I wrote and directed. Yes, it's about me.
Won an award at Sundance.
Yes, it did.
Clap it up for Joe the King. And then the Jimmy Show we talked about.
Yes.
Directed that.
The Jimmy Show is made $750 at the box office. That's not, you can look that up. It's a movie about a stand-up comic who has no sense of humor, no comic timing, and no jokes. Nothing associated with humor whatsoever.
What inspired you to write that? Where'd you get that at? Yeah, where'd you get that idea?
Stupidity inspired me. No, it's actually really, I'm really proud of that movie. I joke. It's based on a one-act play called Veins and Thumbtacks by a very dear friend of ours, Jonathan Mark Sherman, who's got a show in New York now called The Connector, which is really great too. But I acted in this one-act play that Ethan Hawke directed many, many, many years ago. And I was inspired by this character. It's a very sad story, but I think it's a really great story. And it's hard to get movies like that out.
What's your connection with Ethan Hawke? Our motto: be a good friend.
What Former makes lovers?
What makes
like the rest of them?
What makes Ethan Hawke a good friend? Friend? Does he pick up trash? That's hold the door?
No. He and I met on a movie called The Midnight Clear. I forget what year it was. Early '90s, and he was much younger than I was. It was a movie about a platoon of soldiers in World War II. And it was Ethan and Gary Sinise, Peter Berg, Kevin Dillon, myself. I was the best one. That's why I mentioned my name last, even though I said myself. I mean me, Frank Whaley. But it's a really good movie. It's a Midnight Clear. So we met on that. And when you do movies with people, oftentimes, you become friends and then you never see each other again. And he and I, told each other, made a promise to each other that we would remain close. And we formed a theater company together with some other folks. And then he got, too big for his britches. Now he doesn't return my call. So there we go.
He wrote a great book, Rules for a Night.
Oh, yeah?
Quick read, 200 pages. I highly recommend it. It's a knight going off to war. And they're quick little chapters, and it's all character traits. There's a chapter on friendship. Loyalty. Friendship. I recommend it. You should read. Read for 20 minutes a night.
Yeah, let's put Ethan a little lower on the list. How about John Steinbeck, ladies and gentlemen? You're gonna, yeah. Let's read Ethan Hawke.
I liked it.
Said no one ever.
What about, did you die in the Everclear? What's the clear water?
Midnight Clear?
Yes.
Did I die? Yes, I did.
Yeah, bloody scene.
Spoiler alert.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, I did die. Yes, it's a really beautiful, beautiful movie. Keith Gordon directed it. I'm sure you could probably find it, you know, if, you know, some unhoused person is selling used DVDs out of the street, you could probably find it there with the rest of my pictures.
I recommended a book. Do you have a recommendation? Podcast, TV show, movie?
Well, your podcast.
Yes.
Brilliant.
Let's go.
Love is Blind, Sweden. Really good. Southern Charm. Yes. A Clockwork Orange. I don't know.
And yeah, you play pedophile, creep, the boy, guy, Archie, Donovan, Mason, Aaron. You're in Vacancy, Cell, Homage, Swimming with the Sharks.
Anybody can read a resume. Sir.
These are no cards.
Yes, I did play all those roles. You are correct.
What's it going in? Do you go into it different, being a good guy or a bad guy? Is that something that you take from here?
I try to do as little work and research as possible. It's that simple. I try to go into everything just, you know, as long as the writing on the check is sound. I try to keep it fresh and, you know, not think about it too much. You know, a lot of actors, you'll hear them talk about what, you know, what it is. And it's really quite easy, you know, if you do it, if you know, I mean.
Can you get me in?
You could, look at you. You're a tall, strapping, good looking man.
Adam Levine?
Yeah.
I asked for the Travis Kelce haircut. What do you think?
You look a little more like Stephen Levine, my cousin.
No,
I'm sure you can. I mean, it doesn't, you know, it's not, I'm sure it's a tough business, but, you know, if you work hard at it and, you know, all the other bullshit cliches, you can be famous.
Last question. Movies, directed movies, your first one, your last one, your best one, and your worst one.
Of the ones I directed? The ones I've been in.
Oh. Or both. It's your choice.
The best one was probably, I guess people would say Pulp Fiction. You know, I mean, that's a very, very memorable film. The worst one, there's so many. Check out The Cell 2.
Ooh.
They made The Cell with J-Lo, and then they made another movie, which was not The Cell 2, but it was so bad, they said, we gotta call this something. We can't put this, it was called like Horror Night or something. And they said, why don't we call it The Cell 2? Even though it had nothing to do with The Cell 1. The Jimmy Show was probably, you know, my favorite. I don't know if it's, you know, if anybody else would agree. And Joe the King. I mean, the last film I wrote and directed was called like Sunday Like Rain, which I think is a really beautiful film. I'm really fond of the films that I've made myself because they're mine. It's like you created all of this, and you, from your mind, you're doing so many good things for people, and you're bringing people out to, you know, and that probably, that feels really good.
Yeah,
you know,
like, feels great.
So it's the difference between being on someone else's podcast and having your own, and, you know, and creating that, and it's a, you know, other than, you know, giving birth to my kids, which I actually gave birth to my kids. It's the most rewarding thing I've done in my life. Yeah.
Again, give it up for Frank. So say what? So we usually we we're gonna go to our next test, but we always say be a good friend. So 1, 2, 3. You're gonna say be a good friend. Say what?
What?
We're gonna say be a good friend.
What?
Say what again? Say what again? What does Eric Feeney look like?
Stephen Levine, Mike.
Does he look like a teacher? Say what again? Do they speak English in what? What country are you from?
Take it easy.
Ezekiel 25:17 says, thou that righteous man will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger. For thou, I shall not.
Very good. Very good.
Thanks, man. Thank you. Give it up for Frank.
Give it up, everybody. Sing it with me.
Yo, that was great. Let's hear you. Be friends. Why can't we be friends? We can't we be friends? Why can't we be friends?
What do we got, Feeney?
Yo, next up, I'm gonna play this clip of a basketball guy that I play with. He's a great person, great teammate, great friend. Can I play on the phone? Let's see. Is this one on?
Thank you for having me, friend.
Here we go.
You've supported Friends of Feeney in the past. You're a great teammate. Happy birthday.
Thank you, bud.
Happy birthday.
This is the first.
Let's go get that championship together. Let's do it. Listen, are we going to win? I'm confident.
We're going to win?
I'll tell you when. When we win, I'm going to give $500 personally to Friends of Feeney.
Oh,
all right.
I like it.
So you work in your core, and let's go get this championship. All right.
Championship.
Here's to the championship.
Well, John Decker, bring him out. This is a great teammate and friend. JCC teammate, we won the championship last year.
Yes, we did.
He made a vow on his birthday that he would donate $500, so that's why he's here. Pay up. And I'm kidding.
You got to call 1-330 first.
1-330, Jen. But again, thank you. He works financial advisor for Royal.
RBC.
RBC. And should we talk about this year's team?
It's kind of the opposite.
So we won the championship last year. Heroes.
You know what? If we win the championship this year, I'll give you $1,000.
Yeah, no. Like a million.
Right.
We haven't won a game.
We have no one.
Hit the womp, 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 womp.
But.
Sad face.
That kind of comes down to our draft and our coach who drafted, right?
I may or might not have been a captain of that team.
Oh, all right. Sorry.
Thanks.
Yeah, you know, Frank was not going to be like Frank.
But I can't thank you enough. He made a promise on the podcast. Go back and check it out. We had the podcast on his birthday, number 65, John Decker. Any words of encouragement, recommendations?
No, I'm just so proud of you. And, you know, I think one day people are going to say, you know, 100th episode, 100 podcasts, you had Javier Colon, you had Frank Whaley and John Decker, and me. I know two of those three people. Thank you very much for having me here. You do make an incredible difference in the community, and I'm proud to be a part of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Next. Oh, save the date. Save the date. Can you hear me? Save the date. Next week, we're giving out Friends of Fox t-shirts at the Connor game. When Riley Fox scores 2,000 points, and he's a sponsor to that, and also Anthony Abatement. So be there. They play Hall next week.
The 20th, right? February 20th?
Yep. I want to encourage everyone to raffle. Not in yet, but we're going to do their next thing. But I want to talk about the importance of the handwritten note. The importance of the handwritten note. So I was nervous. I'm a teacher. Before I write someone a handwritten note, it goes a long way. They're way better than emails. I was having, you know, nervous today. Eric, I can't believe your leap of faith and started the podcast. Now you're celebrating the 100th episode. You're brave, and I admire you. You're going to kill it tonight. Leah. And my colleague, who left. Leah, tell her tomorrow. Leah, she's my teammate. She's a wonderful teacher. I've been a teacher for 20 years. It brings me so much joy, but sometimes there is heartbreak or tragedy. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna do a quick little thing. I want you to turn to your left. That's this hand. If you put up an L, that's your left. I'm gonna give you 30 seconds. Turn to your neighbor and tell them your favorite teacher and why. Turn to your favorite teacher. Oh, well, find your partner first. Find a partner first. Then figure out who's your favorite teacher. All right, then we're going to say 1, 2, 3, eyes on me.
1, 2, eyes on you.
If you can hear me, clap once. If you can hear me, clap twice. If you can hear me, put your hands on your head.
If you get, there's always that kid. Rob, you were that kid. So, all right, anyone want to share their favorite teacher? Favorite teacher and why? Anybody, anybody? Bella, what'd you say louder?
Mr. Feeney!
Someone get her a mic.
Mr. Feeney!
Let's go, let's go. Anybody else want to share? That was not set up. You got the A+ that I gave you, right? It was 10 years ago. Thank you again, Bella. That was awesome. Be real with Bella. She was on the podcast, too. It was a great podcast.
Littles right there.
Oh,
fair.
Well, it's going to look set up. It's going to look set up.
Mr. Feeney.
He's a current student. No homework for you tomorrow, kid. Hey, for you, no school tomorrow. Let's go! Come on.
Mr. Feeney.
Oh, thank you. Those are Frank's nieces and nephews. That's the reason Frank showed up. Niece and nephew, I had them both. It was amazing.
Yeah.
Someone that's not going to say Mr. Feeney. Ted Newton. Who's your favorite teacher? Rashish.
Or Mrs.
Sebastianelli. Miss Sebastianelli! Sebastianelli said she was coming. Where is she?
I just got a call from my daughter. She is heading to bed, but she gave me a call to tell me that Mr. Feeney!
Let's go, Zoe! She has no school tomorrow because it's her birthday. I told her that today. I was like, listen, for you, no school tomorrow. Well, here's everyone's favorite teacher, Dr. Tracey Wilson. Come on down. And this is her book. Check it out. She wrote The Life in West Hartford. You want to sit and tell us about your book, Tracey?
Sure.
And then we're going to do trivia.
It's a collection of about 150 articles that I wrote over about 12 years that I compiled, I guess, 6 years ago now. And you can buy it at the Noah Webster House, and all the funds go to the house.
Yep. So it's cool. Great book.
And on the front of it, talking about great teachers, on the front of it, this is Louise Duffy. She was one of the first girls basketball coaches in what was then the West Hartford High School.
Wow. And has a school named after her.
And she has a school named after
Duffy. What? Well, I lost my Sharpie. Maybe we'll use this, but I want you to autograph this for me.
Oh, I will.
Okay. Please do. We'll do it later. We'll do it later. And now we're going to two groups that were totally influential on starting and helping Friends of Feeney, the Park Road Association. Give it up for Tracey and Johnny. That was our first Friends of Feeney event was the Park Road Parade, so it's near and dear to my heart. Truly means a lot. So why don't you come on out, Tracey and Johnny. You're going to sit here. You're going to stay there. You're the host.
Right here.
I think. Did I set this up right? You guys are there. And then another wonderful organization, the West Hartford Chamber of Commerce. Again, it made so many friends and connections. I wouldn't be at the Playhouse. Well, I'd probably be at the Playhouse because I knew the Park Road Parade. But I wouldn't be with Direct Line Media because they're part of the West Hartford Chamber. Let's give it up for Chris and Katie.
Oh,
and I got my marker. So hold on, you're gonna share a mic, actually. Sorry, guys. Can you share a mic?
Yep.
Boom.
Loud over here.
All right, I got the scorecard. All right, so two wonderful organizations that were super supportive of Friends of Feeney, and now I'm gonna pit them against each other in a trivia battle to the death. And I cannot thank you guys enough. We're here with Dr. Tracey Wilson. How long did you teach?
38 years.
She only taught for 38 years, so. Can we get all the mics on? We'll do a mic check.
I have something to say, that's why. This mic's not on.
It's on now.
Turn it off, then.
Hold on a second. Dude, Javier Colon, Frank Whaley, and then us. We're going to talk about this.
Yeah, go.
For the record, Jeff Nicholson loves the West Hartford Chamber of Commerce.
Jack. All right, we ready? We're going to go over the rules.
Rules?
Rules.
Oh, yeah.
Each team's going to get five multiple choice questions. You have 20 seconds to answer. I will be timing you. You get 3 points for a correct answer. If you get it wrong, the next person can steal it for 2 points. All right, and the 11th question is a whiteboard question. You're gonna have to write it down. Dr. Trayson will moderate, asking questions, and Feeney will do the time and keep score. Oh, okay, got that. Hold on to that for the final question. You ready, Tracey?
Is there a coin toss for who goes first?
Yes. We'll do an eraser toss. The number 21 is heads. You guys can call home field advantage, your home.
Tails.
It's heads. Would you like to go first or?
What they call heads.
No, we call tails.
Pay attention.
So that's heads.
We'll go first.
All right.
Are you ready?
No, but we're going anyway.
That's a loaded question.
Just want to remind you, the chamber gave you the Noah Webster Award last year.
You'll see by the first question.
Okay.
All right. What is the oldest school building still operating as a public school in town? And you've got a multiple choice.
Okay.
Connors, Morley, Cedric, or the home of Feeney, Wolcott.
Ooh, Wolcott. Am I in the way? Oh, timer, go. Hit him.
You're the talent. You.
I didn't go to any of those schools.
Time running.
There is
a time.
So, we're going to say Cedric.
Incorrect.
Goes to you. For the steal.
Say the four again.
Okay. Connor, Morley, Cedric, and Wolcott.
Morley.
Correct.
3 points. Wait, 2 points. Did you get that? Just a steal. Two. Do you even math, bro?
Okay, so the next question is to you. What was Dinah Road called before its name was changed in 2022? Was it North Street, High Street, Old Street, or New Street?
We think it was New.
Correct.
Ah! Thank you. Thanks to weha.com.
Yeah. I
want to
play this game.
You did this.
Oh.
You need Ronnie.
You want to be president Chuck's of the chamber?
All right. Are you ready?
We are, I guess.
Where is the oldest tree in town? Multiple choice. Is it on Trapper Drive?
You got all rattles.
At Bishop's Corner or in Corbin's Corner?
I think it's the one on Trapper.
Correct. Where is it on Trapper?
It's in the
1700,
old UConn. Yeah,
1700
asylum. In the old UConn parking lot.
Yes.
Which they're saving.
Yes.
They are.
That's why we know.
We have some of the
Okay, way to go. That fell down. Okay. Are you ready?
Ready?
As you'll ever be. Who is the longest serving mayor in West Hartford history? Is it Shari Cantor, Scott Slifka, Godfrey Day, or Nan Streeter?
John Peters.
We say Scott.
You're correct. 12 years. Yeah. Good. All right. Back to you. What's the score? These guys are winning, right?
Yes. It is 8-3.
What is the square mileage of West Hartford to the nearest mile? Is it 28 square miles? 31 square miles? 22 square miles or 17 square miles?
What's killing me is knowing that this is in our community guide and business directory. Oh.
We got 10 seconds. What's the choices again?
28, 31, 22, and 17.
Sure.
22.
Correct.
Oh. Okay, sir.
There's probably 30 copies of that community guide in my car right now.
There you go.
You're selling a lot of
money.
Okay, this is actually a Chamber of Commerce question. All right, Alan B. Judd was the first president of what is now the Chamber of Commerce. What type of business did Judd own? Was it an ice house, a brickyard, a drugstore, or a grocery store?
Drugstore.
You got it.
Sounds familiar.
Wow.
Judd's drugstore.
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 11-7, drugstore.
This is close.
It's close one. Alan B. Judd.
Spanish and Portuguese are the most spoken languages in West Hartford Public Schools. What is the fourth most spoken language? And you have a choice. Is it Vietnamese, Nepali, Mandarin, or Arabic?
We're going to go with Mandarin.
Incorrect.
Go ahead, take it.
Nepali.
Incorrect.
Oh!
Audience?
Vietnamese.
Correct. Vietnamese.
I know.
Okay, and you get the Park Road question. Park Road was dug up, do you remember what year? Anybody?
Which time?
The most recent, 1998.
Oh,
1998. Yeah?
I thought you
were kidding. No, she asked. I thought you were kidding. That's part of the question. What did they find in the road bed? Was it the remains of a human being? Trolley tracks? A time capsule? Or horseshoes? How are we doing?
11-9.
All right, this is a tough one. In 1636, the Wanganunk negotiated to give the land that is West Hartford to the English colonial settlers. What West Hartford street is named after the sachem who negotiated the treaty? Is it Tunxus, King Philip, Sequin, or Tecumseh? Yes. Tunxus, King Philip, Sequin, or Tecumseh?
Just a quick guess. Go for it.
You pick.
Tunxus.
Incorrect. All right.
King Philip.
Incorrect. Anyone?
Sequin.
Sequin. And, all right. Sequin Road, where is it?
Off Albany Avenue.
Good. Okay, so I think, are we back to you? No, we're to you.
Yeah.
What street in West Hartford used to be called 4 Mile Hill and then South Road? Was it Park Road, South Main Street, New Britain Avenue, or Farmington Avenue?
My bad.
Oh,
wait.
Feeney, hold on. This is under protest. We're winning.
All right. Well, it all comes down to this anyway.
It
final question. This is a 10-point question.
If I get my glasses on, they'll make me smarter.
10 points, right?
Okay. This will tell something about what you know about the town. On New Britain Avenue in Elmwood, the Juniper Healthcare mural. Down the middle, there are leaves that are elm leaves for Elmwood. There are four images on the south side of the building. Can you name three of them? Three of the four images.
Four, you get extra points.
Oh, extra.
Yeah, there's a mural. Hopefully you are paying attention.
Tonight.
Who's on the mural? Spelling counts too. Don't.
Literally at the ribbon cutting, and I can't remember.
Yeah. I was there with you. And so was Javier.
So was Javier.
So
was Javier.
All
right.
You can't even.
Just go.
All right.
No, let them go. They got it.
I don't know that we do.
Yeah.
What do you got?
We know one of them.
Well, you got more than we did.
One of them was Javier Colon.
Javier, let's go.
Smokestack.
Tracy and Johnny are not.
I have women, Johnny, Tracy, and Javier.
You got one.
So you got one. We got two.
One and a half.
Two. Okay, why is there a horse on it?
Because they saw the truck.
To get up that big hill.
We used to have a horse track.
Oh, phone a friend. We're going to phone in Ronnie Newton. Okay. From weha.com, also on the podcast. Go ahead, Ronnie.
Ronnie, oh,
get her a mic. Can I get?
Yes.
And Carter at racetrack. That's what the horse is from.
Yes, but there's still one more.
Is it Beach?
Charles Beach. Who gave the land for Beachland Park?
Okay.
And Beth Bye, Commissioner of Early Childhood in the state of Connecticut. Give it up for Beth Bye, future podcast guest. Isn't that right? Charles Beach is correct. Beach.
If we do this again, I'm bringing in the little old ladies in my life. I have a 92-year-old grandmother and a 101-year-old great aunt who have lived in either Hartford or West Hartford for all of those decades, and they probably saw that horse. So I'm gonna bring them next time.
Chuck was our phone friend.
And we had Chuck Corsi. You could have drafted Ronnie. They could have got Chuck. We should have had a. Next time it's going to be an all-star game.
Yeah.
We're picking teams.
Yeah.
150. Come back for our next trivia. Give it up for both contestants. They're huge, huge supporters and very important to the community of West Hartford. Thank you, Playhouse on Park. Thank you, Johnny, Tracy. Thank you, West.
We're in movies with Frank. Ooh. Been all over
yes.
It.
So before we leave, if you stuck around, at the end of the podcast, free ice cream for everyone in attendance at AC Peterson's. You just go say the code is be a good friend and it's free ice cream for everyone. So please don't leave without getting free ice cream. We're not done yet because we still have to hit the raffle. Money, money, money. If this is your name, go see Jen. We got names here. Xbox Games, Rashid. 2 hours at Stringer, Dave Boyer, Stringer. Parkville gift card, Marco Ferreira. Excel Fitness, Leah Clayton, she left. Pizza making, Monique Roy. Is Monique Roy in the building? We'll follow up with her. Float, Kathy Fagan won a float 41. You should try the float. A Reiki session, Jenny Hess with the Reiki session. Your Golf Warehouse, Carrie Lynn O'Neill, Golf Warehouse. a voucher to Playhouse on Park in a water bottle, Jeff and Kristen. Voucher for Playhouse on Park, Ryan Albright. Also a great basketball player. Jeff, you're all right in basketball. The Fix IV, this guy wins the Fix IV every time we have a raffle. Greg Jewell won the raffle. He already gave it to him. Amazon gift card, Sarah Gallagher, which I feel terrible. She's on the town council of Hamden. Frank lives in Hamden. I was supposed to make the connection. Did they connect, I hope? My bad. Mark Moriarty, Donut Crazy, $25 gift card. Golf Tech, Marsha. We got the Golf Tech, you're golfing. Again, free ice cream at AC Peterson's, but we're not done yet. We got money. All right. We're gonna try to do this. Two things. One, if you're on the podcast, come on down. Podcast guests, we're gonna take a group photo. Ronnie, Mark, Decker, Jorge, Chris, you just were on the podcast. Wendy, episode 3. Matt, Avi, Cy Hess.
67.
Dave Pylon, Mike Isco, Keith Griffin. We're gonna do a group photo. Then we're gonna invite everyone down for a group sing-along. Group photo first. Ty, get up there.
No, I got it.
All right, get up for a group photo. We had 100 podcasts. We're hoping for 100 more. Sorry, yeah, dangerous. I don't got that good insurance. All right, you get in there, Keith. Come on.
See the camera.
On three. Don't go anywhere, because then I'm going to hear. Now I invite everyone down here. We're going to sing. Don't go. We're singing now. Now we're going to sing.
We're going to sing.
You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend. We're going to sing. Everyone, come on down. Everybody, Mark, let's go. Group photo. Group singing now. We're singing. All right. You got... Javier. Oh, yeah, definitely give Javier a mic. Rashid, come on, Rinku, get in. Beth Bai, Dr. Wilson, Neela, Christina. All right, get near a mic if you have a good voice. How are we looking?
Let's just put Javier on the microphone.
Mike, Javier. You got a mic in front of you, Mahavi? Here we go.
Okay, this is a little You Got a Friend.
Who needs a lyric?
Mike, check one, two, there you go.
Come on, everybody, get 100 podcasts.
You guys got the lyrics? Here we go.
I'm gonna go in the back.
And
you need a helping. I got the remix. Nope. Attaboy. Throw everyone off. Oh, dry, then think of me.
And soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. All right, sing it loud. You just call. Okay, they want to keep singing more. Let's get ready to go to the second verse. We're ready? Here we go. star.
Go stand next to her for a picture. Pretend you're in the band. I'll take a picture. Take a picture. Up trash, hold the door, give a compliment.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you for being a friend.
Don't forget.
Travel down the road and back again. Your heart is true. You're a pal and a confidant. And if you threw a party and invited everyone you knew, would be from me, and the card attached would say, thank you for being a friend. And if you threw a party and invited everyone you knew, you would see the biggest gift would be from me, and the card attached would say, thank you for being a friend. Night, everybody.